What was your 2021 production?
So 2021 was my first year in real estate. I started in March. I ended up closing 34 units. The dollar volume, I have to go back and look. I think I was around just over 8 million. So that was 2021. And then 2022, so far I've closed 32 units. And I think I'm over the volume that I've done last year. I think I'm close to 9. So we're upping the price point.
Yeah. So we're just over halfway through of 2022. You've already surpassed your entire production, which was a hell of a year, by the way, in your first year in real estate. So you're on pace to double your production in your second year, which is the reason I wanted to have you on. So let's get into, I'm going to just kind of break it right down. So top lead sources, what are they these days?
So to be honest, my top three right now are going to be absentee owners, referrals, repeat clients, even clients that aren't referring me to anybody, but they're coming back to sell or purchase something else. And then foreclosures now have become an interesting lead source in the last couple months that I hadn't really tapped into last year. I'm reaching out to people before they get to that foreclosure point so we can see if we can sell their house and they can get the equity out. I would say those are the top three right now.
Awesome. And right now, like an average month, let's just say this year, how many listings will you take on an average month?
Well, I'm definitely not a mathematician. I can give you the high and the low.
Sure.
So I would say the high, I'm probably looking at about 9.
Okay.
And then the low, worst ever, is 3.
So you're okay, between 3 and 9 listings per month, which is essentially helping you to double the business. You talked about your 3 top lead sources. So your process, your listing process, are you on the outbound lead generation side of the business, meaning you're reaching primarily to these homeowners via the phone, correct?
Correct. Yeah.
Are you doing any door knocking, any marketing, anything outside of outbound phone calls at this point?
No marketing. I like, once I have a listing in an area, or even if I don't have the listing, I like circle prospecting via the phone.
Sure.
The only doors I've knocked have been in relation to foreclosures. Sometimes in-person connection is very beneficial. But overall, when it comes to absentees, no in-person door knocking or marketing, really a lot of just phone and follow-up.
Got it. So your client, the cost of client acquisition for you is 0.
Correct.
Phenomenal. Okay. So let's stick with the phone for a second. What maybe nuggets can you give the audience that you find is working really well that allows you to either A, generate an opportunity, or B, set an appointment?
I would say a few things. Number one, doing the research for the community that you're calling in, the subdivision, the area, really knowing your data, knowing your information, so that you do sound like an expert and position yourself as an expert on the phone, because you will get people that ask you questions. And if you don't know what you're talking about, you're not going to have that opportunity. So knowing the data, and then also I think being a person, connecting with them, letting them speak, not really making it about real estate, just connecting with them on a human level, asking about their family, you know, and if it's not a good fit, you'll find out pretty soon, but really letting them talk to you, they need to tell you what the pain point is. I would just say listening to them, connecting with them. And then also something that I find very beneficial, using their first name. If they're older, sometimes their surname is much more respectful. And I think they appreciate that. And then the other thing is mirroring their tone. So if you call somebody and they're excited, well, you just match that tone. If they're depressed, if they just woke up, you know, that way it drops their guard and you don't have this clash in the conversation.
Smart. Yeah, makes a ton of sense. On the quick question to clarify on the research side, right? So I agree 100%. So that when you can make when you're in the game of having a conversation, you can reference things with more specificity, calling in a certain area that really positions you like you know exactly what you're talking about. So just for the audience's sake, you're not researching like a lead, then you call, lead, then you call, lead, then you call. You're researching an area, calling that area all at once. It's not one at a time, correct?
Correct. Yeah. That would take too long. I definitely I do subdivisions or communities, you know, in one area at one time. And then if I know, hey, there's a lot of opportunity here, I sometimes will even drive through the community myself. Say, smart. Okay, look, so-and-so's got a green door in the cul-de-sac. And then you can reference these things in conversation and really know, okay, we have 15 houses in the subdivision. One mailbox is knocked down. You know, is there an HOA? Can we connect with the HOA? Things like that where it seems petty or small, but then when you're in that conversation with the homeowner, you have a better connection.
It's huge. Yeah, the inches matter. Are you previewing any homes that are listed from other realtors in that area before you dive in to really, to your point, be able to say, listen, I walked through the other homes, the one on Main Street, the one on Elm Street. I walked through both of them. Like, do you ever do that anymore? Or are you
too busy? Yeah, I do. And I would say it depends on the home as far as the price point, because I am trying to up my price point. I don't do it for every single community that I call, but if it's an area that I think would be a benefit to know whether it's the same builder, or they had a specific architect, or the type of model, you know, they had six floor plans in the subdivision, I think going through it, depending on the community, is helpful for sure.
Got it. All right. And then last thing on the phone, and then we'll transition to the appointment. What's maybe a phrase, a script, a strategy that you're using that gets you to get the prospect to invite you to their home?
You know, I don't necessarily use the same exact script word for word each time.
Right. Yeah.
I think it's helpful to probably memorize or know a variety of scripts that you could incorporate depending how the conversation goes. So if they respond positively, more negatively, if they're quiet, I would say I don't necessarily use just one script. So my advice would be to kind of look into all the different scripts that you've taught. Know, give or take, how to say each of them, because opportunity will present itself to use that script potentially. And, you know, I would say the number one thing probably that I get the most appointments would be not being connected to the appointment. So The person on the phone, I'm not desperate to get that appointment. They don't hear it, you know, very casual. Hey, let me tentatively pencil you in, or, you know, and that's of course a script that you taught, or looking at my calendar, I may have, you know, just kind of making it very relaxed. You know, you don't need them. You don't need their listing. You don't need.
I love it.
I would say that probably.
Yeah, I do the same thing. And you're just such a good, I will call you a sales tactician, because you're not selling at all. That's why you're so good, is like the level which you communicate. So you're making the appointment more, you're positioning it anyways, more so for their benefit than your benefit. Mm-hmm. So, okay, got it. So like I will, as an example, I'll position the appointment as, you know, let's just say I'm circle prospecting. I will position the conversation in a way where I say, Nina, I'd be happy to stop by one day this week. I got probably Thursday or Friday open, and I'd be happy to kind of share what other people in the neighborhood are doing to get their property sold. I'll give you the strategy, and then maybe we could talk about some type of relationship in the future, something like that, where There's a thing of value on why they take me up on the appointment that doesn't have to do with listing the home with me, because they right away, it's like, nope. So yeah. Is there anything like that that you find is really helpful that allows you to get these appointments?
I would say, depending how the conversation goes, if I can make a personal connection, let's say the person had surgery, or they're, you know, they got a new dog or something personal, I want to make that appointment, obviously, to have a conversation about real estate. But then I'll often say, and I'll get to meet your dog, or, you know, I want to make sure you're feeling okay after your surgery, just kind of that personal. So there's an appointment, but it's more than just, hey, we are wanting to sell your house. So.
Got it.
You know,
yeah, that's very cool. And so just on the appointment side then of the business, when you go and meet these people, is it often where you go on the appointment for the first time, you walk out of there with a listing, or is it that you go on an appointment, you follow up, and then you get the listing? Is it 50-50? Tell us about the approach that you take when you meet with somebody for the first time.
I would say probably 70% of the time I walk out with the listing. 30% of the time, well, not 30% of the time, probably 20% of the time, it's a lot of follow-up. And then, you know, tentatively listing down the road. And then of course, 10% of the time, nothing.
Nothing happens. Yeah, exactly.
When, you know, going to the appointment, number one is being and dressing extremely professionally, always being early, never, never late, because I mean, I don't have any stats myself, but I can just imagine that that would be a bad first impression. Being extremely respectful, allowing them to talk, you know, allowing them to show me through the home, you know, asking them to talk about anything they've done. So I'm giving them compliments on, oh, you redid the kitchen, I love the backsplash, you know, compliment sandwich in a way.
Sure.
It's really a lot of just a personal connection out.
That's like your secret weapon, right? Like people just, yeah, they feel comfortable with you, right?
Yeah. And I think I want to treat other people how I would want to be treated. So if I had an extremely salesy realtor coming to my home, it's not going to go anywhere. But when it comes down to actual language in regards to the listing, so the pre-listing presentation or listing presentation, there's a few things that I do that I think have worked. I always tell people, you know, my contracts are only for 3 months, because if I can't sell it in 3 months, I'm not doing my job. Yeah. I also tell them that I could fire them and they can fire me. So, you know, if this is not working at any time, we can just end it. And that I do think releases the tension, and it makes them feel that, okay, you know, all of a sudden they want to earn my business at the same time. It's a give and take, which is very interesting. Mainly just being professional, knowing your data, you know, don't think you can go into the listing appointment and wing it. Definitely have to know your information. And that kind of pairs into when you texted me earlier about this, I was thinking skills are very important right now in this market. You know, in 2021, you could list a house and sell it, even if you were the worst realtor in the world. It's not that way anymore. And so you really have to hone in on your skills and your knowledge in order to really properly sell property.
Yeah, really knowing the market. And you, I think you nailed it. Like before, you could put it up at any price, do whatever you wanted, it would sell. Now you really have to know what you're doing, which is super, super interesting. So most of the appointments then on the phone are set with the expectation that you're going to have a conversation about getting their property on the market and getting it sold, if it makes sense. Is that right? Yeah,
definitely. And I think it's the lead source too.
Yeah. Yeah. Because not all lead sources can lead to that on the first call.
Correct.
Yeah. Got it. Okay, cool. And then on the last piece is on the lead follow-up, right? So this is where I think a lot of agents drop the ball, a lot of holes in their business. What's one thing that you're doing right now on the follow-up side that you find is working, whether it be on the organizational side of things to stay top of mind or a tactical thing?
I will say organization is probably my weakness, which I'm still working through. But I would say just thinking of others. So whether it's a holiday, anything really, when I think of somebody, I'm going to text them in that moment. I don't just think, okay, I have to text and email quarterly. I will do those things. But then in addition to that, hey, you know, this property just sold in your neighborhood. Let me call you up. Let me shoot you a text. It's Mother's Day. Let me get a text to all my female mothers, clients, anybody who fits the description, I'll send them a text, making it personal, you know, dropping off gifts. There's even people that I've not sold their house yet, but I'm building that relationship through call, text, email. I mean, you just can't give up on people, because a lot of times they're going to say no half a dozen times or more. I mean, I just had somebody, and I posted it in our group, where it took them a year to finally call me and say, hey, let's list the property. I'd never met them before. I had just had conversations on the phone and text messages. So I would say just remembering other people and realizing it may never lead to a listing, but it feels good that you're caring about others. You care about their life, what's best for them. And I think the most important thing is being honest and giving them the right information, not lying to them and saying, hey, we can sell your property for $1 million, when you know for sure you can't do that. Yeah. And I think people can sense when you're genuine. Yeah. And I don't know. I'm still trying to figure it out along the way, but
yeah,
I think the personal connection is huge.
Yeah. I mean, that's your brand. I mean, that's your brand. That's your slogan. That's who you are. You're winning in business because you are so good at really two things. Number one, connecting with people. It's hard to teach. It's hard to talk. It's hard to teach somebody how to do that, right? So it's like, I don't know. I just, you can't teach it. You're really good at it. That's number one. Number two, I think that you are in doing that, people really feel how much you care. And beyond, I think what you're saying to the audience and to me is like, beyond any tactical thing, it's the intangible things that you can't measure on a spreadsheet, which is why you're winning at business, because people just feel like you care so much more than anyone else. And so they naturally feel comfortable doing business with you. So that's so cool. Go ahead. You want to add something to that?
I was just going to say, of course, you know, you have to do all the other things too. You
can't just,
you know, it's not all feelings. You definitely have to have a schedule and all the stuff that we talk about and that you teach. But there is one thing I have noticed and I think is really huge with people that are being successful now and those who are not with this new market. I think it's easy to get caught up in the news or, you know, oh, there's going to be a crash. But I think if you narrow down and hyper-focus on the everyday activities to get to your goal, I think you'll be successful regardless. And a lot of agents are just freaking out. I think there's no need to. If you get up every day and you have the same habits that you had last year, or even better, you should be able to produce the same or more.
Yeah. And I guess that's a great place to end. I mean, what does your goal look like for the back half of 2022? And what is your mindset going into this new shifting market? You just shared a little bit of that, but do you believe that your business will continue to grow as we come out of a seller's market more to a neutral market?
I think so, because I think number one, I have learned so much during this kind of crazy hectic time. And obviously I have more experience. And so more resources, more connections, more referrals, things like that. But again, I think it's back to what you teach that if you get up each day, if you prospect, if you just do what you say you're going to do, there's no way you can fail. It's when you stop doing it that you'll fail. So is the market shifting? Is the real estate market fluid? Yeah, absolutely. But if you keep those same habits and mindsets, you will be successful because people will see the work ethic and, you know, it's going to be hard work, but there's nothing to be afraid of. There's plenty of business out there.
Yeah, there is. There is. So listen, thank you. I want to keep this short. I want to keep my promise to you and to the audience. I just wanted to keep it super tactical. I had a half page of notes myself. So thank you for jumping on here like this with me all the time and everything that you bring to the community. And I'm sure you and I will catch up soon, but thanks for doing this for us today.
Bye, Brandon.
All right. Take care. Bye-bye.